from the high desert and the great American Southwest. I bid you all good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you may be in the world's time zones. All of them covered very neatly by this program, Coast to Coast AM, or on this night, Ghost to Ghost AM. In the first hour, we're actually about to do something that I think is going to make some sort of history. I don't think it's ever been done on commercial radio before. And it's kind of an extension of last night's program, in a way, with Brendan Cook and Barbara Macbeth. Now, they're into EVP, electronic voice phenomena, the voices of the dead. But they are, by far, not the first to have done that. In fact, it goes back to our earliest pioneers in audio history. It goes back to Tesla. It goes back to the inventor of the telephone. It goes back. And there are things you don't know that have happened. Now, last night, just sort of in passing, I think we hit the subject of, has there ever been an ongoing discussion, you know, a two-way discussion with the dead? And Brendan made reference to this tape, this Spiricom tape, or audio, right, Brendan?
That's correct, Art.
And you, just so that we can get this straight, you obtained this from some sort of journalist in Croatia. Now, this journalist was going to do a story on you and Barb and the GIS, right? And in the, I don't know, exchange of material, he mentioned to you he had this tape and sent it to you. Is that correct?
That's correct. He had contacted us and asked if he would mind, or if we would mind him using some of our material and doing some background on our group to present kind of an in-depth analysis of EVP and the kind of research that's being done all over the world. And we just started, you know, chatting back and forth, and he had mentioned that he was also working with an Italian group, but aside from this Italian group, he had come across the Spiricom tapes. Now, for anybody who's been researching EVP for any amount of time, they are going to be aware of what Spiricom was. Spiricom was, it was almost an extension of what Thomas Edison at one time thought was possible, which was the device that could communicate with the dead and have two-way communication. And he sent us these tapes to let us listen to them and hear, you know, this Dr. George Meek, who was one of the founders of Spiricom, the kind of experiments that he had done and the results that he had got with this. And it's just amazing.
Now, George Meeks may or may not be alive. We really don't know for sure one way or the other, do we?
No, I found out he did pass away in the winter of 1999.
He did. All right. Well, I found his website, and I note, I did make it on. I'll be doggoned. So we've got a link up to the website, and on the website, you know, I'm kind of a technical guy, so I went, they've got a listing of all the equipment they used, very sophisticated equipment for the time, as a matter of fact, in order to achieve the communications that they achieved, which, I mean, this is a startling tape. I sat down to watch it thinking, eh, and by the time I was done, I was going, oh, my God. Now, there's a section of the website. It's kind of a, I don't know, an archive of that website. I'm not really sure. It looks like an archive of it, but they go to great lengths in here to say none of this material is copyrighted in any way, nor may anybody screw with it or whatever it is they say in here. But at any rate, they wanted it out for the entire world to hear. And why the whole world hasn't heard it until now, I don't know. But ladies and gentlemen, what you're about to hear are a group of experimenters led by, was it led by George?
It was led by George Meek and a man named William O'Neill. And actually, this research was done from 1980 to 1982.
Actually, and some of it back in the 70s, I think.
It did start in the 70s, but yeah. The actual machine was pretty much built and fully functioning in the 80s.
And there are schematics, pictorials, the whole business up there of the equipment used. By the way, this whole thing eventually, apparently, became a book, a very famous book called The Ghost of 29 Megahertz. It's based on experiments by John G. Fuller. And so what you're about to hear at first when you listen to it, the very first part of the recording, you're going to go, ah, what a bunch of baloney. It's very hard to hear. But stick with it. Trust me on this. After the little commercial break we do here, get a recorder if you can. Turn your radio up and pay strict attention to what you're about to hear, because I think it is, well, for Halloween, if this one doesn't stand the hair on the back of your head up, nothing will. What do you think, Brendan?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, you know, I've been into EVP for a long time, and even this one got me.
All right, my friend. Thank you very much for the history. Take care.
Take care. Bye-bye.
That's Brendan. And in a moment, we'll be back with what became the ghost of 29 megahertz. Stay right there. As I mentioned, I don't think this has ever been exposed, it says, to commercial radio previously. That was odd. That was really odd. At any rate, tonight it's going to be, and I'm going to have to do it in two parts. The first part, you're going to have a very difficult time hearing. Bear with me. The entire presentation is well worth the listen, if not the recording. Here we go.
Hello, I am George Meek, Director of Research for Metascience Foundation. I hope that by now you'll become familiar with the mind-expanding concepts presented in the Many Mansions chart, as well as those in the text and illustrations in the booklet, The Magic of Living Forever, and the pamphlet, A Photohistory of Man's Communication Systems. With that background, you can better comprehend the significance of the material you will be hearing in this recording. On it, I share with you information regarding one of the most exciting events that has occurred in the long history of man. Since the beginning of time, people in all parts of the globe have speculated as to whether or not death was the end. Thousands of years of such speculation, plus the admonition of religious leaders to believe in a life beyond the grave, still left nagging doubts in the minds of all but the most devout. We were told that life after death existed, but no one could ever pick up a telephone or a two-way radio and carry on an extended and meaningful conversation with even one. Of the perhaps 8 billion persons who have lived on Earth and then died. Well, the message of this tape is that the long silence has been broken. Lengthy, two-way, normal voice conversations with persons who have died are now a reality. They have taken place. They have been recorded. In order to report to you on this momentous development, I will divide the information into several blocks. First, I will talk about the history of attempts to use electronic instruments for communication with the worlds of spirit. Then I'll tell you about the first major breakthrough, followed by the second breakthrough. Then I'll talk about the status of the present research and its significance for all mankind. Lastly, we will consider plans for further research. So let's start with historical background of instrumental communication with those who have died. If you wish to comprehend the breakthrough to be reported later, it is really important for you to absorb the background information that I will give in the next several minutes. The story begins about 60 years ago. The idea of building a wireless or a telephone or a radio that would make it possible to talk to the dead is an idea that has been around that long. Three of the greatest geniuses and inventors of our age, men who helped harness electricity for the good of mankind, and laid much of the foundation upon which our marvels of electronic communication have been based, spent the final years of their lives trying to develop devices for communicating with the world of spirit. These men were Edison, Marconi, and Tesla. They succeeded in much else, but all died without inventing such an instrument. The reason they failed is obvious, at least from today's vantage point. When Thomas Edison died in 1931, scientific knowledge about the nature of energy had advanced very little. The field of solid-state physics, for instance, had not yet been born. Following in the footsteps of those famous explorers are some pioneers whose names will not be as familiar to you. In 1956, two men in California, a photographer named Attila Vanzale and a writer named Raymond Bayless, began the era of what has become known as EVP, electronic voice phenomenon. They recorded on magnetic tape some paranormal voices, voices that should not, logically, have been there. Bayless reported their experiments in a journal of the American Society of Psychic Research in the winter of 1959. The announcement made hardly a ripple. Not a single person contacted either the society or the researchers to inquire about their work. But across the Atlantic, things were about to heat up in the field of EVP research. In the summer of 1959, a Swedish film producer by the name of Fredrik Jorgensen came up with some extra voices on his recordings as he was trying to capture bird songs on the tape in the countryside. Amidst the bird songs, he heard a faint human voice, a male voice speaking Norwegian, saying something about bird voices of the night. Like anybody in that situation would, Jorgensen wondered if the voices weren't just stray radio signals. But the more he listened carefully to his tapes, the more voices he detected that could not be explained as radio transmissions. The voices included some personal messages such as, "Friedrich, you are being watched." And a few weeks later, he recorded what he recognized to be the voice of his mother, who had died 4 years earlier, saying in German, "Friedel, my little Friedel, can you hear me?" Jorgensen continued his experiments and published a book about them in 1964. In addition to using a tape recorder with a microphone, he experimented with making recordings from the radio, then studying them to see if he could detect extra voices. His book was read by Dr. Konstantin Rodiva, a psychologist and author of books on philosophy who lived in Germany. After visiting Jorgensen and listening to his tapes, Rodiva decided to experiment himself in order to answer the question of whether the voices were somehow connected with Jorgensen's particular personality. For 3 months, Rodiva could detect nothing paranormal on his tapes. Then he heard a whispered, "That is correct," in the Latvian language. This was in response to his remark that spirit world inhabitants, like those on Earth, might face certain limitations. Rodiva was encouraged, and he went on to collect a huge number of voice recordings. By the time he published the first book on his work in 1968, he had recorded some 70,000 phrases. Also, he had added some new techniques. He learned that if he tuned his radio to the so-called white noise between the stations, the tapes recorded at those wavelengths would contain voices. Word of Dr. Rodiva's work spread, and scientists and engineers in Europe tried to duplicate his experiments. One of those was Alex Schneider, a Swiss physicist who helped Rodiva develop a new method of recording. The two discovered that voices not heard by the human ear at the time of the recording could be detected on the tape when it was played back. Other pioneers who cooperated with Rodiva included Theodore Rudolph, a high-frequency engineer who worked for the Telefunken firm. Rudolph developed his own recording device called a goniometer. Another colleague of Dr. Rodiva was Dr. Franz Seidel, an electronics engineer in Vienna who developed a device he called a psychophone. Engineers and scientists were not the only people to become interested in experimenting with electronic voice phenomenon. Many lay people did also after reading Rodiva's book. So many began experimenting, in fact, that a German woman, Hanna Buschbeck, started a newsletter in 1969 to help the experimenters keep in touch and exchange ideas. Today, there are more than 1,000 people in Germany alone recording, analyzing, and cataloging paranormal voices. One parish priest in Switzerland, Father Leo Schmidt, has recorded thousands of phrases, and that is only in Europe. Not until 1971 was Rodiva's book brought out in English under the title Breakthrough, An Amazing Experiment in Electronic Communication of the Dead. It was published by the British firm of Colin Smythe, which is a fascinating story in itself. Mr. Smythe was handed a copy of Rodiva's book at a book fair in Germany with a suggestion that he might want to consider publishing it. He turned it over to an associate, Peter Bander, who was skeptical about the whole matter. Until, that is, Smythe himself tried some experimenting with the voices and came up with the voice of Bander's mother, who is dead. The two publishers decided to have Rodiva brought to England so that his tapes and his methods could be checked out by scientists and engineers under controlled conditions. Convinced that Rodiva had, in fact, come up with unexplained voices on tape, they published the book, along with a record of some of the voices recorded. As a result, many more scientists and laymen throughout the world are now experimenting with EVP. So far, I have said little about the content of the messages these researchers are receiving. Frankly, there have been serious problems with these recordings. First, they are very difficult to hear and understand. As an example, let me play you a minute or so of Dr. Rodiva's tapes of the electronic voices.
A request by the experimenter that the voice entities should tell him from where they came is answered by a voice saying, "Delicious lunch." German, land of the soul. A voice later identified as that of a man who lived and died in a place called Kirnbach in the Black Forest, Germany, says, "Wartet auf Walter von Kirnbach." "Wartet auf Walter von Kirnbach."
See what I mean? For one thing, you've probably noticed that the voices are about twice the speed of normal human speech, and that they have a rhythm different from ours. Then, there is the problem that Dr. Rodiva knew many languages, Swedish, German, Russian, Latvian, Spanish, French, and English. Some critics of his work have reasoned, therefore, that what may actually be just stray sounds, he declared to be a meaningful phrase spoken in a language many other researchers would not understand. However, in 1981, our spirit communicators gave us what we consider the correct explanation of multiple voices. They said that whenever an EVP researcher establishes an open channel to the spirit world, where there are many persons who want to communicate, it is as though several grab the microphone and all try to speak at the same time. What comes through is a mixture of words and phrases, often in different languages. Then there are the psychologists and experts in psychic phenomena who have proposed some alternative explanations for the voices. The words and phrases could be just messages from the subconscious of the listener, they say, or from the subconscious of someone else, projected somehow onto the tape. One director of a nursing home in Germany, for instance, reported recording the voices of patients who were supposedly not conscious at the time. Most importantly, even if we assume that the voices on the tapes are those of people no longer living on Earth, we have to admit that what they have to say is rather trivial. A person may find reassuring evidence of life after death if he hears the voice of his mother, whom he knows to be dead. For the rest of us, the snatches of speech so far recorded on tape seem to have little value except to provide one more bit of evidence that life appears to continue on a different dimension after we die. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that Jurgensen, Rodiva, and the other electronic voice experimenters were wasting their time. Far from it. The significant thing about their work is that they did take that first, most difficult step in communication with another level of existence. It was comparable to my own first step 57 years ago when I experimented with the only kind of radio equipment then available, a crystal of galena and a wire cat's whisker. At the time, it would have been almost impossible to convince me that clear, static-free radio communication would be feasible, and relatively soon, too. Within just my lifetime, we have progressed from that crude crystal set to TV broadcasts to our planet from space devices more than 1,000 million miles away. So it shouldn't be discouraging that Jurgensen and Rodiva's communications with the worlds of spirit were at first very crude. That is simply the nature of scientific research.
We're going to hold it right there for now, and you ain't heard nothing yet. Then they invented the way to actually talk to dead people, one dead person in particular. This is all scientifically documented on the website, the Spiricom website, which we've got a link to, and it's rapidly going to collapse as more and more people head up there, because the next segment you're going to hear, well, you're going to have to decide for yourself. The documentation is unimpeachable, absolutely. I'm Art Bell from the high desert in the middle of the night. You're listening to Coast AM.
Call the wildcard line at area code 775-727-1295. The first-time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll-free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call Art at 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art Bell by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5. And dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the Internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
The scientists who did the Spiricom experiments that you're hearing this morning wrote a very unusual notice regarding copyrights, patents, suppression, and harassment. And as I pointed out earlier, stay tuned, you ain't heard nothing yet. All researchers affiliated with MetaScience Foundation during the 10 years of worldwide study of problems and potentials of electronic communication with the so-called dead have shared a common goal. They want the fruit of their labors and financial contributions to be made freely available to people of all races all over the world. Therefore, on their behalf, I state that, one, we have not filed for any patents in any countries on the many inventions represented by the equipment presented herein. Two, the material in this report has not been copyrighted. Three, the name Spiricom has not been trademarked. But please note, everything in the cosmos is energy of one sort or another. And although all energies can be used for good or evil, it is our hope that the hundreds of individuals and organizations which carry these developments forward in the decades ahead will use them only for the good of all mankind. If any individuals alone, acting alone, or as part of a corporate entity endeavor to use these inventions solely for money-making purposes or to the detriment of any person, they are herewith forewarned. They should know that the first stop for them, after they sooner or later shed their physical bodies, will be at the bottom of the lowest astral plane, as described on the MetaScience diagram entitled, In Our Father's House, There Are Many Mansions. We are gradually waking up to the fact that our universe and all therein operates on the inexorable law of cause and effect. None can afford to scoff at the admonition, quote, as ye sow, so shall ye reap. Any effort by any individual or organization to suppress or destroy the material contained herein will be useless. Any attempt to in any way harass the harmony of the MetaScience research team will be pointless. The material contained herein has been described and distributed throughout the world to more than 1,000 persons who are dedicated to the ultimate perfection of a clear, static-free, dependable system for communication with those persons now living in the higher worlds of spirit who desire to bring enlightenment to mankind. George W. Meek. It's the voice you will hear again in a moment. It's about to get really good. Stay right there. It appears as though most of the participants in what you're hearing right now have themselves passed away. But their research has not, thank God. They documented it on the web. We've got a link up there for you. If you want to read the many schematic diagrams, see how they actually did what you're going to hear, take a look. It's on coasttocoastam.com website right now. In the meantime, back to George W. Meek.
Techniques are perfected only with the passage of time. The quality of the voices on the tapes began to improve, but very slowly. Let me play for you now an excerpt from some of the tapes made in 1977 by Raymond Cass, a hearing aid specialist in England. The German words following the comment by Mr. Cass are repeated a total of 3 times.
Hello, we're still here. We're packing up now to go back to Bridlington. And if there's someone here who is with us.
You'll agree that is a little easier to make out.
Not
I personally became involved in EVP research in 1971.
Stay tuned, though.
I was an electronic engineer and an inventor with more than 80 patents to his credit. He and I opened a small laboratory in Philadelphia. By 1975, we had become convinced that an apparatus far more sophisticated than what I found then being used in Europe would be necessary. We also decided it was desirable to obtain help from the other side, that is, the active collaboration of someone who had died and who wanted to work with us in achieving two-way communication. That was easier said than done. About this time, we met William, an electronic technician who had well-developed clairvoyant and clairaudient capabilities. In other words, he had the ability to see and hear persons in other dimensions. With his help, we made contact with a man who, dead for 5 years, had been a medical doctor on our plane of life. Doc Nick, as we came to call him, had, fortunately, also been a ham radio operator. He suggested that instead of the so-called white noise traditionally used by EVP researchers, we should use certain audio frequencies. These would serve as an energy source against which the sounds produced by Doc Nick's vocal cords in his astral body could be played. Remember the electro-biochemical diagram on pages 13 and 14 of the Magic of Living Forever booklet that shows the astral body? He said the result would be that our ears and a tape recorder would pick up his voice. This suggestion sounded plausible to us because we'd observed that all EVP voices had to steal energy from radio frequencies, spoken or sung words, music, or natural or artificially created white noise and so forth. After some experimentation, we had the great thrill on October 27, 1977 of hearing Doc Nick's first words just barely coming through the quite loud mixture of tones we had provided as a starting point. To you, hearing it for the first time, this short exchange may be almost as difficult to understand as the EVP voice samples given earlier. Here's the exchange.
Stay tuned, everybody. Still very hard to understand. These are the very early experiments you're hearing, so stay tuned. Actually, almost an annoying tone, huh?
Hello?
the idea of providing a tone, a frequency for the other side to modulate. That's what you're hearing. But still, the good stuff lies ahead. I know, very difficult to understand. I attempted to skip ahead, but I really want you to hear all of this.
We really can't blame William for being a bit scared when he had his first communication with someone who had been among the so-called dead for 5 years. But he showed his own good sense when he remarked to Doc Nick, "Who do you think will believe anything like this?" Our position in releasing these materials is precisely that of Doc Nick when he replied, "Don't worry about that. It's not important. Believe me." Those who scoff at this information, even after carefully evaluating this tape and related printed materials, may later find themselves in the embarrassing position of one member of the French Academy of Sciences years ago. He told his learned colleagues, "I personally have examined Mr. Edison's phonograph, and I find that it is nothing but the clever use of ventriloquism." If some of you scoff at our breakthrough, it is probably because Doc Nick sounds a bit like a robot. We certainly agree that he does. But please recognize what you just heard for what it is. A start had been made towards someday getting continuous two-way conversation instead of jammed together bits and pieces, phrases that were characteristic of tens of thousands of the earlier EVP voice recordings. At about this time, it is our great good luck to come into contact with a scientist among the so-called dead who identified himself as Dr. George Jeffries Mueller. We remembered the 2,000-year-old injunction in the Bible to the mediums of that day to test spirit communicators. So we checked to see that Dr. Mueller really was who he claimed to be, and we hit the jackpot. He told us where we could find a copy of his death certificate issued in 1967. He told us his Social Security number. And he told us intimate details of his life and scholastic activities at the University of Wisconsin and Cornell University, his instructorship in physics at Cornell, and his top-level jobs in government and industry. His photograph and biographical data are given in our publication entitled Spiricom. The fact that Dr. Mueller had written a textbook on electronics and had had a lifelong hobby of studying the theory of music enabled him to help us carry the research far beyond the level we had reached with Doc Nick and further refine our understanding of the audio frequencies we needed to arrive at our second major breakthrough. It occurred on September 22, 1980. Here it is.
William, you're getting much better right there, William. Yeah, I'm cleaning you, William.
Yes, sir, I understood, Doctor.
Very well.
Okay.
Everywhere that Mary went, the land that all
Doctor. I'm sorry, I was lighting a cigarette. Yes, I did, Doctor.
Very well.
Very well, Doctor.
1-1-1-1-2-3-4-5.
Well, Mary's little lamb certainly is adding to its claim to immortality. But since one of the first rules of science is that of replication, nothing could be more gratifying than to have Dr. Mueller's conversation confirm that we had at last established meaningful instrumental communication with a person who had shed his physical body. Now, thanks to Dr. Mueller's contributions to the new communication systems, we want to share a remarkable conversation with another communicator. What makes it remarkable is that he says he died 151 years ago. Fred Engstrom, which is how he identifies himself, says he lived in a rural area in Virginia and died in 1830. Our check of the scanty birth records of that place and time has not yet confirmed his existence then. But as you learned in The Magic of Living Forever, serial time, as we know it, does not exist in the worlds of spirits. When you listen to this next conversation, observe that this quality of Fred Engstrom's voice, while still robot-like, is vastly better than that of Doc Nick's voice at the time of our first breakthrough.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
The following examples of Dr. Mueller's voice are taken from many hours of two-way conversations with him, some of which lasted for half an hour or more. These tapes represent the present limited capability of the electromagnetic etheric device we call Spiricom, a word coined by taking portions of the two words spirit and communication. This particular device is called Spiricom Mark IV.
All right, I'm going to hold it right there for the moment, and there's just a little more to go. What you're hearing is real. What you're hearing is absolutely real. The documentation for the equipment used to produce what you're hearing is available on the webpage that has...
Bell. Call the Wildcard Line at area code 775-727-1295. The first-time caller line is area code 775-727-1222. To talk with Art Bell from east of the Rockies, call toll-free at 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies, call 800-618-8255. International callers may reach Art by calling your in-country Sprint access number, pressing option 5, and dialing toll-free 800-893-0903. From coast to coast and worldwide on the internet, this is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
It is. Good morning, everybody. Actually, Ghost to Ghost AM, and we're going to be taking open line calls on entity attacks shortly. Just a little more to go. George W. Meek was a scientist, a engineer, and he did decades of work along with others on direct communication with the dead, and they achieved it. I've got just a little more to play for you in a moment, and then we're going to begin taking calls. And again, I understand that some of this is very difficult to understand. However, what you're hearing is real, on real life, ongoing two-way communication with those who have passed away. It's decades of work. It deserves to be heard. What you're hearing is historical. Everything is vibrational. It's thought now there are many universes. None other than Dr. Michio Kaku and other very reputable men have alluded to that fact. That may well be the communication you're hearing tonight. So once again, here is George W. Meek, and we'll finish this up quite quickly, but listen very carefully.
The following examples of Dr. Mueller's voice are taken from many hours of two-way conversations with him, some of which lasted for half an hour or more. These tapes represent the present limited capability of the electromagnetic etheric device we call Spiricom, a word coined by taking portions of the two words spirit and communication. This particular device is called Spiricom Mark IV. The great value of the technical assistance given by Dr. Mueller is dramatically shown by this next excerpt, taken from a Spiricom conversation in April 1981. Near the start, he gives his reactions to one of the audio frequencies and then proceeds to pinpoint an electronic circuit problem on the video apparatus on which he and William were working.
Just a minute, Doctor. Yes, I know you're here, but I'm going to cut down the volume of these other frequencies. Cut them down to a level that wants,
how very specific Dr. Mueller was in pinpointing the problem on the experimental video device on which he and William were working. He said the problem lay near the third transistor in the preamp unit. The problem was an impedance mismatch and could be corrected by using a 150 ohm half watt resistor in parallel with a 0.0047 microfarad ceramic capacitor. What better proof could science want that Dr. Mueller's mind, memory banks, and personality are still alive and functioning in a useful and most dramatic way? And now we share an excerpt in which they further discuss our Viticom research project. Incidentally, the problems of developing a workable Viticom system seem even more monumental than those of perfecting Spiricom.
What's that again?
Thank you.
you perhaps noted that Dr. Mueller turned aside from the microphone to talk with another spirit person standing in the lab. William was unable to see him visually or clairvoyantly, or to hear him clairaudiently. The spirit, who told Dr. Mueller his name was Nathaniel, seemingly could not talk through Spiricom. With Dr. Mueller as intermediary, William and Nathaniel discussed boyhood activities, including pranks, in which they had both participated more than half a century ago. The contacts with Dr. Mueller were sporadic. Days and even weeks would pass with no contact, even though William left the electronic equipment turned on. Then Dr. Mueller would pay an unexpected visit, like this one. Equally frustrating, there would be a totally unexplained termination of contact in the midst of a very useful conversation. Here is an example.
Well, I understand, but a lot of things I don't understand. Do you have any suggestions, Doctor? Do you have any suggestions? Dr. Mueller? Dr. Mueller? Oh, boy. Dr. Mueller, are you there, sir? Oh, my God. Dr. Mueller. Oh, boy.
In the early months of our conversations with Dr. Mueller, the electromagnetic factors, the phase of the moon, sunspots, or other unknown factors resulted in poor quality of Dr. Mueller's voice, as you will notice in this excerpt, in which Dr. Mueller responds to William's mention of possible surgery. These comments and his observations and his own death 14 years previously are worth careful listening, even though the poor quality may try your patience. On more joyful subjects than surgery and death experiences. Often, Dr. Mueller displayed his delightful humor. In this excerpt, he speaks of his fondness for carrots and cabbages.
Yeah, I just turned on the tape recorder, Doctor.
Oh, very well, William.
You said to hurry back, and I did. That has been exactly 1 week ago.
Ho, 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 yourself. There you have it. All right. listen, I'm going to stop it there. There's an equal, another portion, an equal second portion to this. But what you've heard back from the days of Tesla, literally beginning with the days of Tesla, it was thought and experimented with. And what you just heard was the result of decades of experimentation. And I want to again stress that any of you involved in electronics would want to go up to the link on our website where it is very carefully documented what was done, exactly the kind of equipment that was used, the schematics for that equipment in order to actually communicate with the dead in the fashion that you just heard. And of course, that's now very old technology, but I believe what you just heard was quite historic, very historic. I know trying the patience of some who probably could not hear it. Others, I imagine, heard certain parts very clearly. And again, there were a series of tones and audio vibrations that were used to allow the dead to modulate something with electromagnetic force. And that's what you heard. You heard the modulation of tones by electromagnetic force that became audible if you listened carefully to the human ear, and you heard, no doubt, you must have heard some of the ongoing communication. This work, these schematics, these diagrams should all live on for somebody else to grab onto and now begin that experimentation. All of the documentation is there if you want to pursue it. I thought there would be nothing more bone-chilling on a Halloween night than hearing the real thing. That's what you just heard. So thank you, Brennan Cook. Thank you to the person in Croatia who passed it on. Decades of work, now not lost.